Hi, Jeremy Cordo in the Court of Public Opinion. I'm just on air here to let you know that we'll be live streaming the Court of Public Opinion every Friday between 9 o'clock and 12 on jeremycordo.com. Please join us. We'd love to have you.
In the holidays, I went to my sister's place to have a few drinks and hang out. And her partner, Luke, wanted to play a game with me that he came up with 10-odd years ago. And it's called King Pong.
Yeah.
Okay.
Wait, so he came up with this one.
Yeah.
It's, you know, he's designed all the rules. It's all up to scratch.
Well, him and a bunch of other people, came up with this game, King Pong. It's a mixture of beer pong and King's Cup. A game that was described to me as there are no winners, just survivors.
I can see Luke having, like, T-shirts made up or something with that slogan. You know, the guy just hasn't let go of the game from his glory days.
Yeah, so a real quick rundown of the game. It's teams of two, and you split like a deck of cards down the middle,
mm-hmm.
and you put one card under each cup. So each team has 26 cups in total with a card underneath. If you sink the ball into another player's cup, they have to then flip the card underneath, and whatever the rule is, they have to do after finishing the drink that you sunk.
Okay, right. So you're really just doubling up drinking games there.
Yeah. It's
please drink responsibly.
That is a crazy hybrid of a game, though. You know, King's Cup alone is just pretty dicey at the best of times, you know?
Oh, that sounds... Yeah, it sounds like you get really trapped in that game and never come out the other side. Yeah,
it's a long game. It can take up to 2 hours. And so as we're setting it all up, he's telling me this story back when him and a few friends came up with it. Like, 10 years ago they did it. He was living in Canada at the time, and they were going out and trying to decide what game to play, beer pong, King's Cup. And just like that old El Paso ad, mm-hmm. they said, why not both?
Yeah.
And combine the two. And it started off with just six teams, and it quickly took, like, it got quite a bit of momentum over in Canada. And eventually, after about a few weeks, they had a full list of 30 different teams with all different random people all around.
It was rivaling the NHL for a little period there. It was getting the same pay-per-view subscriptions.
So now they've started this whole competition. They've got 30 teams. They're doing, like, this knockout-style tournament. And my sister's partner, Luke, is playing in one of the finals against a Norwegian team. It's these two Norwegian blokes.
Wow, so it's really captured hearts all around the world, this game.
Yeah, it truly has.
And livers.
And, you know, I guess being responsible for coming up with it and everything and playing it for a while, I think the confidence got to him a little bit, because he makes a bet with this Norwegian team, and he says, look, loser has to leave town tonight.
Yeah, okay, like banished from the town.
Banished from the town.
So does that mean, hey, you know, leave for the night, go outside
of
the state borders.
Leave town, never come back.
Never come back.
Leave town, never come back.
Sorry, man, I have my... my visa says I'm meant to stay here for another 5 months. I have a job.
Nope,
he's
you're
like,
lost.
No, well, it's obviously, you don't know the game rules.
So these two Norwegian blokes, they agree to the terms. They're like, all right, why not? Loser has to leave town. So they start playing, and it's a tight game, a real nail-biter. They get down to the last cup. Pressure is on.
Yeah.
And they lost.
Oh, no.
Being true to his word, Luke and his mate have packed up their things. They've got someone to drive them to the border of the town in Canada, and then just walked and hitchhiked to another town and stayed there.
What?
Never to return. Never to return.
What an awful car
so
ride.
So dramatic.
You know, there's one thing to lose a game, but then to be in the car ride where you're being banished from the state. Like, it's insane.
I watched a tear trickle down his cheek as he remembered the story.
What about you just flip the rules on him again? You're like, hey, Luke, you know, if you lose this one, you have to get out of Australia. And you obviously can't go
back
to Canada either.
Over a game like that, that is a ripper punishment. That's a shocking punishment, hey?
Yeah, it's one of the all-time best ones I've heard. But I want to open up the phone lines here. How bad was the punishment, Adelaide? Were you playing What Are the Odds? Was it a stupid bet like this over a game with mates?
Oh, I mean, I'm sure there's so many for the drinking games as well, because have a few drinks, the rules get a bit loose, a bit wild.
Yeah, I was playing What Are the Odds at Fool's Festival a few years ago with my mate Sean, and they got me really good. It was one in 120. 20. We both said 64. Mm. And my punishment was to show my friend Sean one boob.
Would you have doubled
just
the odds?
Just one.
Wait, two boobs if you doubled the odds? Or, like, yeah, why just one?
I don't know. There's lots of punishments that have come through on the text line here. I drank my... Oh, far
this one's
out.
Gross as well. You have to read it, though.
I drank my friend's pee after losing a running race. It was warm and I wanted to cry.
Nah, no good.
Nah, sorry about that, fresh fam.
Good. Sunset, I was playing a round of kings and I got through the dare. I was dared to allow my friend to wax my back, sack, and crack. She heated the wax a little too much and my crack was red raw for weeks.
Oh, disgusting. It's good to be back, hey?
Monday morning, Pierre.
I hope no one's eating breakfast at the moment.
Definitely people are.
Another text. punishment for losing Twister was playing the next game in the nude. My mate saw angles of me they didn't need to see that night.
I hope that's the same person.
Yeah, who's that a punishment for, really? Like, if you're playing nude Twister, is it your mates or are you the one getting punished?
And really, you could be a nudist, a proud, you know, free baller, and you quite like doing that, so it's not a punishment at all.
This one here just screams lads mucking around. It says, I was dared to jump off my roof onto your trampoline. I'm 100 kegs and I ripped through it. No injuries, just shame.
Huge. Jeez. Someone said they had to do a nudie run down Anzac Highway for a bet.
Yeah, that's rough. Another one here. I used to have the punishment of losing beer pong by running over hot coals.
Oh my.
One day a guy fell over on the coals and we had to call it quits.
Yeah. Yeah, you would.
As you should.
You
probably shouldn't have done that in the first
place. That's wild. That's these problems with these games. You get too excited about these punishments, and then you end up doing something stupid, like this person here who said, I had to shave an eyebrow the night before my mum's 60th birthday after losing a bet. My whole family was so angry at me because I ruined all the photos. Yeah,
bit of makeup.
Definitely ruined it.
Bit of makeup, you'll be right.
You're listening to Davo, Tom and Callum, the podcast.
So over the holidays, just last week, I went up to the river. It was good up at Morgan, Scott's Creek. My family has a few shacks up there and they were kind enough to have us for a few nights.
Couple of river rats.
Yes, absolutely. And standard river behaviour, lots of swimming, lots of bevs, lots of mischief.
Lots of barbecuing.
Yes.
Did anyone have a boat or anything, any of the skiing?
We usually have a boat. This time we didn't. So we just made the most of the river, having a good swim. It was fantastic.
Very good.
But after a few nights there with my cousin Sarah, who's an absolute menace, I was pretty rinsed, if I'm honest.
Yeah.
She's a little bit younger than me, has a bit more stamina, gives it heaps.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah. And of course, like we said before, the river really changes a man.
Yeah.
When you go to the river, changes a man or woman, you know, you become a bit rowdier. There's no rules. It's like international waters
there,
isn't it?
That's true. It's river rules.
Yeah, it's river rules.
Oh, God. Yeah, well, that's exactly what it was. And so after my two nights there, I was feeling a bit dusty and I was driving home. It was early in the morning and I was sort of just, you know, needed to get home. I was done. And it's only about a two-hour drive from Morgan to Adelaide. But while I was driving, I was feeling pretty rough and I thought, nah, I need to pull over and have a little kip or else I'm just not, you know, not being safe on the roads. So I did that. So I pulled over in the middle of nowhere, probably have an hour left of my drive, not that long, but, doing the responsible thing. And I closed my eyes and let me tell you, the second my head hit my pillow sitting in the driver's seat, I was out like a light. A good 30-minute snooze and I sort of woke up and I go, right, it's time to get moving. Mm. So off I go. I try to start my car. That happens.
Uh-oh. Terrible sound.
It's a bad sound.
Especially, are you feeling like rested, you know, after the sleep, or are you in the agitated mode already? It's one of those naps that you're just a bit, you know, a bit frantic.
No, I felt rested, but I was still a bit rattled, obviously, and I'm thinking I'm in the middle of nowhere.
Yeah.
Like, for goodness sake.
Do you have service? Could RAA come out?
Yes, I had service. But what I did, I had left the lights on while I snoozed.
Oh. Jeez, you duffer.
I know. And I've had that many troubles with my car recently. You'd think I would have learnt my lesson. But I sat there for about 20 minutes in pure defeat thinking, it's a new year. You know, I thought I'd have some better luck. Things are looking up, you know, 2024, let's go. And this is the way I'm starting it. And I just can't be bothered dealing with this. So a good 20 minutes passes and I try and start the car again. Nothing. Yeah. Absolutely nothing. And my heart sinks.
Double trouble.
And I thought, you know what? I just got into a frantic state where I just kept trying to start the car. Starts again. Nothing.
Did you try rubbing your feet on the ground and shocking the engine?
No.
Get the battery going?
But what I did was I prayed to the gods. I hoped. I said, please, if you get me out of this without me having to call REA and then join them, you know.
Yes, this is the quickest way people convert to religion these please. Days. They have car troubles.
And one last go and the bloody car starts.
You beauty.
2024, baby. Let's go.
Year of religion for Davo.
Put down the mic.
What's in the podcast?
What's in the podcast?
Davo, Tom and Callum, the podcast.
I want to have a quick chat about Christmas. Now, I know that seems like a lifetime away at this point, but how was your Christmas?
Yeah, it was good.
It was good? Right.
Nice?
Yeah, pretty. Oh, well, to be honest, I was a bit dusty. I didn't leave my room.
Really?
Except for lunch and dinner, of
so
course.
Just of course,
the cold meats and the prawns.
You
they
love
were,
Christmas.
Yeah. You opted for a tray to be slid under your bedroom door while you played the PlayStation. Just chuck the prawns under the door, just wedge it under.
Well, mine was pretty good until my mum had a few too many red wines and she started toggling between being really overly emotional and then dancing to this song. Sugar. But it was tears running down her face while she's whistling and dancing to this song, like through her teeth, like whistling through her teeth.
Why is that song so sentimental?
No, it wasn't. It was just chaotic.
She loves that episode of The Simpsons.
I said to Mum, I'm like, look, we've had a full day of family stuff. I am needing to get away from this energy. Yes. Love you. But no, I want to go back to Christmas brunch. We won't talk about my mum's escapades on the day, but Christmas brunch, we did brunch this year with the family and we did all the brekkie trimmings, you know, ham and cheese croissants, bacon, eggs, muffins, all this stuff. It was really lovely. Nice. We didn't do the roast stuff either. It was just really simple Christmas this year. And to be honest, I actually enjoyed it.
Yeah, good.
Other than my mum's chaotic teeth whistling at the end of the night.
Well, something had to happen. You can't have a perfect Christmas.
No, definitely not. Well, after the feast, we're sitting around. You know, everyone's had their breakfast trimming, and my 42-year-old sister, 42, says, "Wow,
meaning of life."
That's the what?
42. It's the number. It's the meaning of life.
You're gonna hate it. It's a movie reference. I actually watched that for the first time the other week.
I was going to say, I'll let you guys get this out. All right.
So it was 42.
So my 42-year-old sister says, wow, that's the first croissant I've ever tried. And hey, that's delicious.
Wow.
What?
She's 42 first? And never had a croissant.
How has she never had a croissant?
I don't know.
Is she living under a rock?
No. She's had a very worldly life, let me tell you.
It's so bizarre, though, isn't it? Because it's a classic... It's a classic cafe food, though. I mean, it's everywhere. It's not, you know, you don't have to go to France to have this delicacy. Like, you would see it just on every corner block here in Adelaide.
Yeah, there's plenty of ways you can have a croissant as well. She just never, ever tried it.
Yeah, right. And was it just a classic ham and cheese croissant?
Ham and cheese, toasted, delicious, obviously. Yeah. Obviously, but 42, never tried it. Never thought she would try it.
That's insane. Hey, let's open up the text line here. What food will you just never try? Or what food haven't you tried?
Yeah, speaking of Christmas, there's a real funny one. The Christmas Eve party we go to every year with family, friends, like the same people for the last, like, you know, 25 years.
Mm-hmm.
There is one family that bring a banana curry to bring that to the table. And I kid you not, it's one of those I've looked at every single year and thought, that is so offensive. I'll never touch it.
Never.
And my family never touched it either. And that's why it's so glorious for them, because they know no one's gonna go for it. And they love it. You bring a pasta salad.
So they have the whole banana curry to themselves.
To themselves. They don't, because you bring a hard-hitting thing like a banana, like a potato salad or something. You know, everyone's cracking on that.
Yeah.
This, though, they know they got it to themselves.
Sounds awful. Banana curry, no thank you. I'd never try sardines. And I never will.
Sardines on toast are a beautiful thing.
What about spam? Spam's never been like that appealing either. Unless I'm in Hawaii or something. And it's like
it's a delicacy
best,
over
best
there.
Spam I can get. I'm never going to eat that from a can.
Somebody's texted in here. Peanut butter and jelly sandwich.
See, that's such a bizarre kind of American one. Like, I don't think... I've never had it, but I think I would try it. But I'm never in the case where I have a pot of jelly at home to slap on a sandwich. Well, like, it's so odd, isn't it?
When they say jelly, they mean jam.
Yeah. Oh, so I thought it was like actual jelly, right?
Yeah, no, not aeroplane jelly.
Yeah, I was going to say, it sounds interesting, doesn't it?
Someone else has texted and says, I will never eat mac and cheese. I am Italian and it's just not right.
Do yourself a favour, have some mac and cheese. It's great.
Yeah, surely. Also, this one here, I have never had a prawn and never will. Disgusting.
Nah, do yourself a favour again. Have a prawn. They're great.
Obviously, you over there, bing guts. Yeah. Loves it all.
Do yourself a favour.
Look, I'll be honest, there's not a lot of foods I don't think I would try. I think I'm up for almost anything.
Well, famously, you're up for anything.
Should go for this one, though. Plant-based meat alternative. Saw plant-based pastrami at the shops yesterday, and it looked like a vac-pack slice Play-Doh.
Yeah, look, they're not selling it, but I was vegetarian for a while. I did have some plant-based meats, and not all of them are that bad. Mm. There are some really good ones
out there. Some are bad, though.
Some are, yes.
That doesn't sound good. This one here says, my sister says she would never eat an oyster, but now she's tried them. She requests them at every family event.
Mm. Yeah. If you don't like oysters, I mean, grow up.
I don't like oysters.
Grow up, Davo.
Not even with the bacon and other gear.
Oh, no. You don't like the Kilpatrick. No. Kilpatrick is a saver if you don't like the seafood taste. We got this one here, though. Someone said, would have to put a gun to my head to get me to try mortadella.
Jeez, get the mac and cheese person onto them, the Italian. Another person here texting in, I refuse to eat avocado texture. It's a no from me.
Nah, you're missing out. Get out of here.
You're missing out.
How controversial is this one? Once again, speaking of those Christmas kind of foods, someone said Christmas pudding with fruit. Fruit and dessert just isn't my vibe, and it's warm. Gross as.
I mean, you're just saying you don't like pavlova as well then, right? Yeah. You're not having fruit and dessert.
It's an Australian crime.
Grow up, Adelaide.
You're listening to Davo, Tom and Callum, the podcast.
Guys, I need to talk about an advert that popped up on my Instagram. You know, it's the start of 2024. Usually you get a lot of gyms, don't you? You get that sort of thing coming through.
Yeah, like HelloFresh, stuff like that.
Yep. Now, this particular advert, I'm not going to reveal what it is about just yet. I want you guys to try and guess what it could possibly be. So I open up my Instagram and the advert opens and this is the backing track to it.
I used to float.
Okay.
So it's very emotive, quite inspirational, a bit sad. You know, there's plenty of sort of vibes that it brings.
There's a lot of emotion with that one. So, it does really boggle the mind what ad that could be for.
Yeah. What do you guys think it could be for?
Well, I know for a fact they use this song on the ad teasing the new Home and Away that's coming up. I hate Home and Away, but considering that it's on Instagram, I reckon it's going to be something absolutely insane. And I'm thinking maybe inspirational, motivating. Maybe it's for, like, Lego.
Okay.
Right?
It's building. Interesting.
Yeah, I don't know.
I'm going to go
a shot in the dark.
I'm going to go pretty out there. Real shot in the dark as well. I'm going to go incontinence. It's it's for covering up those urine patches if you wet yourself. And I think it's an interesting song choice. But
we've got family friendly and whatever that is.
Yeah, well, I think, they're trying to hit in with the emotion that people could feel, you know, a bit insecure about it. So that's what they're going for.
No, the advert playing this music is about a stain remover.
Oh, so the incontinence.
So the way this is, the advert opens and it's a chicky babe biting into a strawberry.
Yeah.
And then what she does is she gets the strawberry and she puts it on her pants. Like, she bites the strawberry and then wipes the strawberry on her pants. Mm. And the writing that comes up while that music is playing says, it's strawberry season. Make it a carefree one.
Really? Oh.
No.
Nah.
Get the chamois back.
Oh, podcast, my podcast. Oh, podcast, my podcast. Oh, podcast, my podcast.
Davo, Tom and Callum, the podcast.
Bit of a weird one to get up to in your holidays that I didn't think I would do and I've never really done before. Went to a murder mystery party.
Oh, I'm surprised that you haven't done one of these before. I feel like this is right up your alley.
100%. It's definitely an understatement. Like, I loved it. It was so much fun. But, you know, it was for a friend's birthday and they'd hired up a little cottage kind of thing in Wollonga, like an Airbnb.
Yeah.
everyone could go to, and invited a bunch of people just for, yeah, what was a murder mystery party. And we got the email, we got the invitation, and it pretty much tells you the theme and the backstory of what's going to happen. And the theme, right, the theme is like 1800s Victorian England, like a bit of a Bridgerton, like the TV show kind of thing. Ah. So the old school England kind of vibe. But I have to say, one of the more unusual things when I arrived there, and it was a bit of a crux of the night that a few people did bring up a few times, they, for copyright reasons, can't call it Bridgerton. They had to call it Brocherton. But, so we all got this, like, these envelopes saying, oh, you're the Duke of Brocherton.
Honestly,
you're, you know,
how would these TV producers find out this little cottage in Wollonga is doing this?
Yeah, we just get insane. We get stormed by snipers and a black hawk helicopter because we're playing the murder mystery of Brocherton.
All right, so you've gone down to Wollonga for a Brocherton murder mystery party.
Murder mystery party, okay. Yeah. And it was quite weird. Like, it is quite interesting how it works, because you do get emailed your assigned character that is chosen by the host in advance. So right. I guess if you really wanted to do some method acting in your own time and get prepared for the actor, the character.
Which no
Not
doubt
that
you
I did.
Did.
That. Well, yeah, 2 weeks in advance.
Who'd you get then?
Yeah. So a few of the different characters, right? And I was slightly offended by who I got because it was chosen by the host. So the host is chosen for himself. He's chosen a snobby doctor, someone who treats only the best people and is sort of having a few affairs around the place.
Okay,
so juicy.
It was juicy. Nice. There was a painting instructor. She's a starving artist. She seems quiet, and then she bursts out into anger and starts yelling at people. So that would have been a fun one to have, actually.
Okay.
That was my second pick, if I wanted one. The character I got...
You sound so nerdy in this.
It's not that nerdy. The character I got, though, the Duke of Strutting, the season's most eligible bachelor, thinks he's hot, brags a lot.
Yeah,
he was just a dick.
Yeah, that tracks. Really,
I feel like he just took your bio, your Tinder bio out.
That's what's
that
written on the
name.
Fresh 92.7 website,
yeah.
Isn't it?
And pasted. But yeah, when I saw that, I was like, "Are you kidding me? Brags a lot. You can't chuck that." And Michael, the dude, the host, was like, "I thought it would just suit you quite well." And it's like subtle dig, isn't it?
Not really all that subtle, if I'm honest. So what happened? Like, who got murdered? What happened?
So that's the other really funny part of the night. And once again, a bit of a crux that people did bring up quite a bit. Because it was illustrated by Michael, the host, as a murder mystery party, everyone thought, geez, this is going to be spooky. Where's the murder? When's it going to happen? Mm. Michael reveals to everyone, hey, guys, it's a little bit more tame. It's more of a Gossip Girl kind of situation. No one's getting killed tonight. So it's just a bunch of people spreading rumours. So you had to figure out who the rumour maker was. No one died.
So you went all the way down to Wollonga for a murder mystery party.
Just to find out who was chatting shit.
You're listening to Davo, Tom and Callum, the podcast.
We need to have a chat about Eshays.
Oh, Eshay, man. Oh, you trying to start something, lad? I'll start something any day of the week, yog day.
Yeah, you know the ones, Eshays. Their trademark look is the cross-chest bum bag paired with three-quarter-length designer tracky dacks, sweatshirt, trucker-style cap.
It's such a crazy subculture, though, isn't it? And, you know, when you look at the designer brands and everything, like, it's just so interesting. And, of course, you know, Rundle Mall, bit of a hot spot. See them down there.
Train stations.
Yeah. Massive hotspots.
Yeah, I mean, remember that time I got bullied by an Eshay? She was like 14 years old. She made me buy her a packet of chips.
Where was that?
In the Gold Coast.
Oh, yeah, that's right, yeah.
Also, another hotspot for Eshay is the Goldie.
What was it? Yeah, it was just in the servo. And
she bullied me into buying her a packet of chips. I was terrified.
Expensive chips too. Red Rock Deli, probably. She wants the gourmet stuff.
No
Smiths.
But the reason we're talking about Eshays today is because there's a generational war. There's a generational war between the original Eshays and the new Eshays.
Oh, Eshay, man.
Does anyone really care enough?
I mean, the Eshays do.
The Eshays. It feels like a Twilight vampire werewolf kind of war. Like, they're two big groups going head-to-head right now.
Well, it's classic sort of growing up and not liking the younger gen. You know, that's something that happens all the time. Yeah, you know, we always think, oh, the next generation, oh, they have no idea, blah, blah,
Boomers
blah.
Boomers don't like millennials. Millennials don't like Gen Z. Yeah. Gen
exactly.
Z won't like whatever the next one is.
Yeah, it's a pattern, right?
And the subculture of Eshays is no... different to that going on. But basically, the Daily Mail has come out and they've gone out and they've found a bunch of Eshays to talk to about this. And they've found a little fella named Cade. Now, let's talk about Cade in the photo.
Yeah. He's got the Lacoste bucket hat. He's got the big, thick gold cross chain. Of course, the bum bag, a Burberry shirt, filler shorts, and of course, the Nike TNs.
Mm. Yeah. The Nike TNs are a staple from what I'm reading in the article. But it's so funny that when they've interviewed Cade is standing there in a food court looking quite respectable.
Putting
his hands together to look quite respectable. But Cade says, new members don't understand what it's really like to be a lad and instead focus on being a nuisance to the public.
Yeah. I like how he's calling them grubs.
Yeah.
I think later in the article he proceeds to call them gronks as well. So, he's still getting the Eshay language in there.
Exactly, right.
It is interesting that his whole stance is, it's anti-trouble. They're not there to cause trouble. That's a younger generation thing.
Well, apparently, but I don't know what the older generation are up to. This Cade guy reckons he's upset as well because you can't stand in more groups of more than three or more people because people think you're out for trouble.
Yeah,
he can't hang with his mates anymore.
Well, not when you're looking like, the Kate. Lacoste bucket hat, the thick gold cross chain, the bum bag, the Nike TNs. If you're all dressed like that, I'd be crossing the road.
Well, you know what? Like, they do have this thing about the dictionary here about the way that the Eshays do talk. So I thought I'd give you some sort of things that you could listen out for in public just in case you want to spot
them. If they're in disguise.
Yeah.
An Eshay could be in a suit and a tie. You never know.
An Eshay could be your boss. Yeah. Could be a neighbour.
Could be your doctor.
If you hear someone say etswa, they mean sweet.
I thought that was going to be buy me some chips.
Adlay, they mean lad.
Oh, yeah.
Red hot means risky.
So is this pig Latin?
There's a little bit of that. I mean, red hot sounds a little bit interesting. And Gronk equals an idiot. So just so you know.
Hey. So there's a generational war between the Eshays here.
Yes.
Young versus old, tale for all time.
Yeah. See you at the mall's balls to see how it ends.
All right. I get older. The Davo, Tom and Callum podcast stays the same age.
It's our first show back, our first show of 2024.
Wild.
And this is the year I'm cutting the shit.
Uh-oh. Oh, no. Here we go. Starting early.
Yeah, get in early. I'm starting off with a fashion trend I'm more than happy to see die. Mm. Of course, we're chatting Crocs.
Crocs. Yeah, Crocs has weird resurgences, doesn't it? Because, one of our mates got really into it and would wear the Crocs around all the time, but it was in that period where they weren't really favoured. And then they came back, and then they went, and then they came back.
Yeah, well, they launched 20 years ago now.
Really?
Crocs. Far out.
Yeah.
God.
But it wasn't about until last year, maybe even the end of 2022, where people started wearing them. This would have given most people the ick 10 years ago. Mm-hmm. But now apparently they're cool because a bunch of influencers started wearing them, which caused the masses of 13-year-olds to buy them, and now they're cool.
See. Well, to be fair, I always hated Crocs, but I'm not going to lie. The last 2 years, I was like, Don't do it. They look comfy.
They're not.
Yeah, what's the appeal for you? Because I guess you do have the influencers, but I always thought they became a bit popular because they are a bit dorky and gimmicky and a bit ironic, you know what I mean? That's why I thought people would get around them.
Well, I think if the influencers are doing it and they look cool, then I could wear them too and look cool, you know?
Yeah, I mean, Crocs did lean into this whole big fad of Crocs becoming popular, and you could buy Croc accessories. You could get little headlights for your Crocs,
and
little
giblets,
charms.
They're called.
Giblets. My bad.
You really are up to date with your Croc knowledge.
I've been looking into them, mate.
Mm. You know what's cool as well at the moment? I'm being a bit hooked by it. They've got some Star Wars ones, and they've got some Harry Potter ones. There's all these different cool little,
I'll let you in on a little secret. Yeah. When I wore Crocs when I was a wee lad, right? Mm. Blisters everywhere.
Oh,
blisters all over the feet. Never again. Never will I wear them. And we're going to see the end of Crocs in 2024 because Croc wearers are in for a bit of a tough 2024 because a lot of train stations, some airports and shopping centres are going to be banning Crocs inside.
Why?
Well, it comes from a few scary incidents of people's Crocs getting stuck in escalators.
Oh, my God. Yeah. Imagine being stuck on an escalator.
At least they slip off.
But then people see you're the person with Crocs coming from your honeymoon in Vanuatu or something, and you got your Crocs on. Like, you just
leave him, honey.
Stupid.
You're listening to Davo, Tom and Callum, the podcast.
all these talks of X everywhere. You know, it's the huge thing. Everyone, you know, talking about X with guys, X with girls. But there is a big, heavy article, a huge list that has come out to survey the big X within blokes for the last year.
Mm. Okay. I mean, it's starting to...
It's getting petty, these X,
isn't
hard.
It? It's hard to live your best life when you're getting disgusting people every step of the way.
Yeah, no, yeah.
It really is like, and I feel like because, you know, we've been doing this show for, you know, 2 years or so now, and it's, you know, this kind of segment does come up a little bit where you get an updated list of the X. It started off quite minimal.
Mm.
Yeah. I remember back in the day, there was maybe 10 X for a guy.
Yeah, it was like chasing a ping pong ball.
Yeah.
You know, something like that.
Little stuff. And now progressively, as we go on, the list gets bigger and bigger in these surveys to the point where, like you said, you can't even live anymore. You can't go outside the house.
Nah. Absolutely not.
I mean, this list that we're looking at the moment has 85 icks on it.
Yeah, and that's written down, you know, people being questioned and submitting their own and stuff and getting votes. And, you know, when you look at it, there are a few that do make sense. Some of them, you know, talking about their ex, bad breath.
Yeah.
Chew loudly with their mouth open.
All things that can be changed pretty easily.
Yeah.
As well.
Yeah. So there's a few of those where it's like, okay, yeah, I understand how that would be an ick, and you know, it's reasonable. However, when you look further into the list, what's getting the most votes and what's concerning is things like ordering a dessert. Can a man not order a cream brulee anymore?
Yeah, right.
I like this one in there. It says, use the menu on the chocolate box to pick a chocolate to eat. let him choose which one he wants.
No, that's fine. You don't want to pick a crappy one, do
you? Exactly, that's what I'm saying.
Yeah.
What about this one on there? They reckon that another ick, which, like I said, I'm not for these icks. I think we're at the point where we just got to be kind to each other.
I'm glad you're being progressive, Davo. Giving us men some slack on the icks.
Yeah, just this once. But it says, can't clap to a beat.
What about rude to restaurant staff? That's fair enough. Yeah. We got don't wear socks with shoes.
Wait, what?
If you don't wear socks with shoes, it's an ick.
Mm. Oh, if you don't?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Yeah. I'm with that. Sweaty feet. Gross.
Another one they've got on the list here is take off their necklace before getting intimate.
Yeah. Yeah. But see, it's just one of those, like, you can't help it. Take the jewellery off.
You don't want to ruin it, you know?
The medallion swinging around.
Babe, this chain is too thin.
Yeah. You're going to yank it off.
What about this one? People can't help this. Have short fingers.
Yeah. What about these body ones? Right next to
Audi over innie, yeah.
Right next to ordering cocktails is an ick. They have having a short neck. Oh. Can't help that.
And men apparently can't take baths anymore without icking women out.
Jeez, what a world to live in.
I mean, hopefully 2024, let's get rid of the icks.
Yeah, I reckon.
Let's all live our lives to the fullest and all be happy.
Ick free.
First rule of the Davo, Tom and Callum podcast is you don't talk about the Davo, Tom and Callum podcast. The second rule of the Davo, Tom and Callum podcast is you don't talk about the Davo, Tom and Callum podcast.
Guys, we are officially in 2024, and the further we go down, there's no real sign of woke culture slowing down, which, don't get me wrong, good thing, but it's fair to say sometimes we can get carried away with some woke things.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, it doesn't really matter the level of wokeness. There's always someone going, oh, well, you can't say anything anymore.
Yeah.
Isn't there?
Well, over at the Tate Modern Art Gallery in London, something's happened you can't really help but laugh at. And this is a puppet show from Egyptian artist Wael Shawky, who acts out historical events with marionettes. Now, because they're historical events, there is, of course, death involved, which in a puppet would look like
a puppet
without being puppeteered.
Yeah, well, literally, it's just
a puppet without a puppet. Yeah, exactly.
Take the hand out of the puppet, and you got the dead corpse. You know? It's not that offensive to look at.
However, they have put a trigger warning on it for a puppet show. They're puppets, and there is a trigger warning because they're historical events.
I mean. What do you mean? Like, even if there is a war, it's not like they can, you know, have, like, blood flying out everywhere.
Red cellophane tape.
What's,
going everywhere.
What's, like, It is just, like, bizarre, though, isn't it? And like you said, puppets, I feel like it's the one artistic medium that you feel like you could get into as your career and be safe that no one's going to cancel you. You'll be like, I'm a puppeteer. No one's going to touch me.
I mean, as a kid, I didn't want any trigger warnings for when I watched The Lion King and watched Scar, you know, betray his brother Mufasa off the cliff.
Oh, and thank goodness for that. We don't need any more of this.
We don't need it for puppets, right?
I never thought I'd say it, but give the puppeteers a break. Just lay off the puppets.
Give them a break. Oh, my God.
Hi, Jeremy Cordo in the Court of Public Opinion. I'm just on air here to let you know that we'll be live streaming the Court of Public Opinion every Friday between 9 o'clock and 12 on jeremycordo.com. Please join us. We'd love to have you.